well, I've collected 20 stories from my years as a travel writer that are reflective of all parts of the world, lots in Asia, but also in Europe and South America and North America and Australia. And it's just representative, not just of 10 years of travel, but 10 years of travel writing. And then one thing that I added to the book to make it to offer a little bit more than your average collection of travel writing is endnotes to every chapter, which is kind of like the DVD commentary track where the director talks about the film. Mm-hmm. For every story, I have endnotes that refer to specific places in the story that talk about the decisions that went into writing the story. And at one level, it's sort of meant to be a little bit of a primer on travel writing because it breaks down the stories by how they were, by the thought process and the experiential factors that went into the story. Mm-hmm. But also to show that it's sort of a way of being honest, that you always have to, in travel stories, you always have to reduce your experience to the size of a story. And so much experience is so much richer and more disorganized than what you could ever put in a story. And so stories have their own rules, and a lot of that is entertainment and keeping people involved and not giving them too much information. And then those end notes are a little peek into the chaos behind the actual lived experience of each story. So people have reacted really, really well to it. It's been a fun book. Traveling alone is my default. I'm pretty good at being a solitary person. Mm-hmm. And as a writer, it's so much richer to travel alone because you are engaged with your surroundings in a way that you aren't with a companion.
Right.
And I'm not going to knock traveling with a companion. I've done it a lot. But when you're traveling with a friend, especially someone you've known a long time, then pretty soon you're going to be walking through the streets of some place far away making jokes about college or however you know your friend, right?
Right.
If you're traveling alone, then you're forced to confront your own loneliness.
Mm-hmm.
You're forced to interact with your surroundings. Sometimes even you're forced to just sit and watch, you know, whereas otherwise you might. And of course, again, going back to the smartphone thing, the smartphone can become a companion for a solo traveler. And
right.
Instead of encountering your own boredom, and I've this happens on the Philly subway now. I might normally have talk to people or just watch people and become a part of the city,
mm-hmm.
I'll pull up my Instapaper app or my Kindle app or you know, listen to a iTunes U lecture,
right.
And then suddenly I'm pulled out of that place.
Right.
So the gift of solo travel, I think, is that it forces you into certain situations of interaction, which come out of boredom or loneliness, and those probably the top 50 travel experiences I've had come out of simple forcing myself to be creative in the face of loneliness or boredom.
Mm.
And in fact, it was easier in a certain sense because I realized how many travelers carry a bunch of dirty clothes and unnecessary things as they go.
Mm-hmm.
But philosophically, it's an extension of how I've been aiming to travel and live for over 10 years. I've just always felt that traveling light and putting oneself in the experience beyond whatever gadgets or comforts of home you bring is what travel is all about. And I think it's becoming increasingly difficult these days because it's so easy to bring home with you when you travel. You know,
mm-hmm.
that you can bring enough electronics and enough comforts and enough diversions that it's pretty easy. I mean, I just got an iPhone a couple months ago, and I can see how it takes a lot of discipline because I have, you know, tons of books and articles and iTunes University lectures and music just on my iPhone, and it's a distraction. It can be a distraction. It can be a comfort, but it can be a distraction in travel that didn't exist 10 years ago. So I guess it all just sort of feeds into the notion that experience is what, well, it's the vagabonding philosophy that time is what we're given and experience is what is how we should spend our time, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's another element of fear that some people don't often speak even rationally about money. You know, money is seen as something that there's never enough of. And people don't relax and think, well, how can I use my money in such a way that I can live the life that I want to live?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's something that Tim Ferriss wrote about too. But it's in the core of vagabonding, is that I think if people relax and realize that everybody has a certain means in which to travel, then if you see your wealth as time instead of money, you can just live. You can live in a better way. You can live a more deliberate life, and you can enjoy what it really is that you that makes you happy and that makes your life worth living and your time worth experiencing.